Hey guys, how are you? This is another Writing Time with Will. I have a funny feeling I'm going to have to change the schedule just a little bit for right now, just to go from Mondays publishing these to getting them published on Tuesdays, just because of the work schedule. I didn't know for sure if I had to make it official or not, but I'm making it official now. So anyway guys, if you like what you see, before we get started, if you like what you see, if you like what you hear, I'd greatly appreciate if you go ahead and like, comment, subscribe below. Please comment. Above all else, I love talking with people. I love dialoguing. And so I love to dialogue with you. And here's the question for the setup for your comments. Who's your favorite hero in literature? There you go. Today I'm going to expand a little bit more on the hero's journey because there was some stuff that I unintentionally left out. So I want to make sure to go over everything I need to go over. So right now I'm going to start that process. The first part of the hero's journey is referred to as the ordinary world, and that's the area where the hero is grounded. That's where he starts the story sometimes. You know, it's like the hobbits in the Shire. You know, it's like Luke in the area he's in where he's working with Uncle Owen. It's like, you know, different characters starting at home. It grounds him, it gives him a human experience, but they have no idea what adventure is about to come their way. Then, there's the thing called the call to adventure. The idea about the call to adventure is that that's the period of time where he gets the call. It sounds just like it says. And sometimes it can be something as simple as, Gandalf coming to the house and explaining what's gonna happen and how the ring has to get to the volcano, and how even though he doesn't want to do it, he knows he has to send Frodo to go deal with it. And Lord of the Rings, I mean, I'm not talking about the Hobbit itself, but Lord of the Rings, he has to go for himself instead of for us. Then there's a refusal to the call, the idea that I'm not worthy enough. I have fears, I have concerns, I can't possibly. You know, talk a little bit last week about Luke saying, you know, well, I'm a nobody, I'm just a farmer. Yeah, I've shot womp rats, but I've never done anything like this. Then there's the meeting of the mentor. In The Hobbit, for example, Gandalf kind of becomes the mentor, not just to Frodo and the rest of the hobbits, but he also kind of becomes the guide to the others as they join the quest. He really, in a lot of ways, becomes the central motivation for a lot of the stuff. Because even though the ring is the whole motivation, he is the one that helps guide the mission during the time. You know, you look at Star Wars, Obi-Wan Kenobi is the guy who is the person that's going to, you know, basically, you know, start the mission. He's the one that mentors Luke to begin with. Now, there is a pass-off point because he ends up passing him off to Yoda in Empire Strikes Back because he died, you know, near the end of A New Hope. Then there's crossing the threshold. The hero is now ready to act and ready to go out on an adventure. In some cases, they may have to be pushed, because the hero may not still feel like he's able to do what he needs to do, but he does, you know, he's getting closer to actually going out. And then you have to test the allies and the enemies. This is where you start building the party. If you're playing a role-playing game, this is where the party starts forming. This is where the Han Solos and the Leias and the Chewies and the R2s and the C-3POs and the future king of Arwen and all these different characters come aboard, and Gimli and Legolas and all these people come aboard. This is where you start going through trials to see what's going to happen to keep you from getting to the goal. You know, and the goal of Lord of the Rings is to get the ring to, you know, the volcano to destroy. Well, Sauron's not just going to sit back. He's your antagonist. He's not just going to sit back and be like, oh yeah, they're going to get to the volcano, no big deal, right? It's not going to work that way. They're going to send tests and trials to stop you from doing it. Even to the point where Frodo, it gets tempted so many times by the ring. It's even funny. That in and of itself is a test in and of itself. And then there's that approach to the innermost cave. This is the area that represents many things in the hero story, such as the actual location that may lie in terrible danger or internal conflict, which may up to now the hero has not really had to face. As the hero approaches that cave, he must take final preparations before taking the final leap to the great unknown. This is the moment in Empire Strikes Back when Luke goes into the cave. And, you know, Yoda's like, you know, you only take in there what you take with you. And so, you know, it's that moment for Frodo when he's, you know, looking at the ring, and you know, and Bilbo is there, and you know, he's sitting there, and he gets to see what the ring does to you. And so he really has to question, you know, can I do this? And he even tries to run away and do it on his own because he doesn't want to run the risk of hurting the rest of the party. Then there's the ordeal. It's a supreme ordeal that may be a dangerous physical test or inner crisis for the hero that they must face in order to survive, or for the world in which that hero lives to continue to exist. Sometimes there's also some sort of death, possibly to the character, a reborn experience. It may not be a physical death, but it may be a death of an ideal. And so those ideals are things they have to go through in order, those things have to die so that the person can be reborn with a new thought process, a new way of looking at life, a new way of dealing with the situation, a new hope in themselves. And then you have the opportunity for the reward, or what is referred to as seizing the sword. This is the moment when you get some sort of artifact that really kind of clinches it in and you begin to understand it. You know, it's referred to as after defeating the enemy, surviving death, and finally overcoming his great personal challenge, the hero is ultimately transformed into a new state, emerging from the battle as a stronger person, and often with a prize of some sort. You know, they gave Luke the lightsaber early, but he really didn't get to understand it really until Empire. You know, he really started, you know, I mean, he started the fighting with it, different things like that. And so by the time he challenges Vader the first time, he still really hasn't, you know, come into his own. It's not until Return of the Jedi, when he comes back, that he's actually at peace with who he is as a person. And then the next step is the road back home. This is the stage of the hero's journey that represents our first echo of the call to adventure, in which the hero has to cross the first threshold. Now he has to return home with his reward, but this time the anticipation of danger is replaced by the acclaim, or perhaps the vindication or absolution, or even exoneration. You know, Luke had no idea what bringing the Jedi back was going to mean for the world. And so, you know, his coming back home, really, you know, if you look at the other movies past that, you know, especially Last Jedi, you begin to realize that becoming a Jedi like he was brought a lot more pain and suffering than he realized. Even just through the whole Kylo Ren thing. If you've not seen The Last Jedi, I'm not going to spoil it for you, but, you know, let's have that discussion too. How do you feel like Luke's hero's journey ended? There's another question for you in the comments. And then Resurrection, this is the climax in which the hero must have his final and most dangerous encounter with death. The final battle also represents something far greater than the hero's own existence, with its outcome having far-reaching consequences to his ordinary world and to the lives of those left behind. When he faced Vader that last time, there was that point where the Emperor kept saying, you know, give into your anger, give into your anger. Kill your father, join the dark side. That would have had massive repercussions on the back end had he went ahead and did that. But he just ended up throwing his lightsaber down. He said, I'm not going to do that. And then that had the opportunity to ignite the spark of light that was in his father, and his father was able to overthrow the Emperor. So that was a powerful thing, but he had to be willing to give up, almost basically give up his life. And at the end step, it's the last step, but it's the 12th. It's the final stage of the hero's journey, which he returns home to his ordinary world, a changed man. He will have had to grow as a person, learn many things, face terrible dangers and even death, but looks forward to the new start in life. His return may bring back a fresh hope to those who are left behind, a direct solution to their problems, and perhaps a new perspective for everyone to consider. When Frodo has to leave the Shire at the end of Lord of the Rings, it's interesting because he makes it back to the Shire. He said he always wanted to make it back to the Shire, but he couldn't stay because he had been tainted by the ring. And he knew that if he stayed, that there would be more danger to the people around him. So he had to make an ultimate decision in that regard. Now, there's some of y'all that have read the Lord of the Rings stuff. I've never read them. I've watched the movies. So I'll admit my ignorance to that end. But if you have opinions or values, different values on it, go ahead and discuss that too in the comments. I want to hear what you're saying. But anyway, guys, that's the basic hero's journey. That's what I really wanted to kind of expound on last week's Writing Time with Will. So when you write your heroes, guys, those are some things you can go by and look at as you write your heroes and as you develop them for your stories. And please do me a favor. When you're developing heroes, please develop the villains too. Think of the villains as well. You don't want a one-dimensional villain with a three-dimensional hero. It doesn't work well. Anyway, guys, as always, thank you so much for everything you do. Thank you for liking, subscribing, and commenting in the videos that you've already commented in. God bless, take care, and above all else, be blessed and be a blessing to somebody, guys. Take care.